Our next speaker is Cook County Board President. She is a frequent attendee of City Club of Chicago events, for which we are enormously grateful. Ladies and gentlemen, Cook County Board President, Toni Preckwinkle. Madam President.
Thank you, Jay.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Our guest today is the treasurer of the City of Chicago. He's steward of the City of Chicago's $7 billion investment portfolio. He also serves as trustee or fiduciary on five of the city's public employee pension boards, with nearly $25 billion under management. He also serves as chairman of the Chicago Infrastructure Trust, which invests in long-term investments, job creation, and economic development of the City of Chicago. Our guest today was sworn in 1 year ago, and he honors the City Club by joining us today. Ladies and gentlemen, Kurt Summers.
Okay, in tradition of my former boss, I'm going to follow suit and say good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
All right. We've all been well trained. Thank you, Toni. Thank you, Jay. Thanks to you all for coming today. As was noted before, my wife Helen is here. I want to thank you for being here. Here we go. I also want to thank my mom, Sherry, who's in the back there. And I want to wish her a happy belated birthday. 2 days ago, she celebrated an anniversary of her 29th birthday. So happy belated, Mom. I'd also like to acknowledge that there are many elected officials in the room who I'm just thankful that you're here. Thank you for supporting. Too many to recall or recount offhand here, but thank you for being here and for supporting the City Club. and finally, I want to just say a quick thank you to my staff. If the members of the City Treasurer staff, if you guys could just stand, I want to give you a round of applause. You guys are fantastic. In the audience. One staff member that's noticeably absent is Christy LaFleur, our Chief Operating Officer, who went into labor on Sunday and introduced a new 7-pound, 6-ounce baby boy into the world. So we thank her and congratulate her in absentia. So it's great to be back at the City Club with a year in office under my belt. It's really a fantastic feeling. After all, I stood at this podium a year ago today, having been sworn in just hours prior, and literally was asked by an audience member, I think it might have been Paul Green, so you just started, what can you tell us already? And in fairness, there was some truth to that, Paul. A year ago I talked about my passion and optimism about the opportunities for this city and the fact that this office of the city treasurer has been under leveraged and under resourced for very long and for far too long and should be a pillar of the future of economic prosperity for the city and its residents. Today I can honestly report that my passion and optimism and commitment and belief were well placed. And the other day when I was reflecting on this speech and what I'd come here to say, I was asked the question, what are you most proud of in the last year? And I'll admit that I struggled. I struggled for two reasons. First, while I know we've delivered a great deal of value to the people of Chicago, we've begun to transform this office in new ways. We've professionalized our approach to investing. We've generated more revenue. We've engaged communities and really interacted with people in this city unlike ever before from this office. All of that is true. In large part, I feel like while it's true, it's something called just us doing our job. And so I was struggled with this question of pride and what are you proud of when you're just doing your job. Frankly, we shouldn't be held to relatively low standards of performance. We shouldn't be graded on a curve. We work for you, and we should be accountable at a higher level. So while I believe we've set an unprecedented standard for this office, for our performance, and for public engagement and accountability, this should be the rule and not the exception. It shouldn't be something that we beat our chests about. It's something that we put our head down, put one foot in front of the other, and keep doing tomorrow and the next day. The second reason I struggled is because of the events of the last week. How hard it's been to watch the city that I love go through this challenging time. How hard it was to watch the killing of a 17-year-old Laquan McDonald. How hard it has been for me and the rest of Chicago not to let our anger and distrust lead to counterproductive actions. I struggled because I've been as disappointed in us as I have been proud. As elected leaders, civic leaders, community leaders, we still have so much more to do, and it's more important now than ever. I'm going to talk about this more in a second, but here's the headline. We can no longer ignore entire segments of our population and believe that it will lead to the best outcome of our city. It's not possible. Our fates are inextricably linked. Let me be clear. There is a broader impact on our local economy when we allow for disinvestment, inequality, and violence to continue. It's all of our problem. It's not a black problem. It's not a Latino problem. It's not a white problem. It's not an affluent problem. It's every person in this room's problem. It impacts all of us greatly. Some personally, some individually, some with family members, but all of us who have a belief of a better city and a better Chicago, this matters to you. That young man's life matters. The 10 people who have been shot since the tape was released matters to you. It matters to our economy. It matters to your household. It matters to the future of your children and grandchildren. So we can no longer act as though there isn't a direct correlation between the breadth of economic opportunity and resilience of Chicago's economy. And fundamentally, as taxpayers, we can no longer afford the high cost of injustice, disinvestment, and inequality, a cost that shows up in our jails, courtrooms, hospitals, public assistance programs, and even our morgue. As I wrestled with these two issues that I'm sharing with you as I prepare to do this, I reflected on this first year in office. And it was actually a great process for me. It reminded me of the stories of people across the city. It bolstered my resolve. We've been able to achieve some goals and some things to truly be proud of in terms of the way that we're helping people, to contribute to making a difficult situation with our finances in the city, our budgets better, and to prove that we can all have an impact if we focus our efforts on making a difference every day. And that means that we can take that same resolve, that same spirit of tackling what may feel like insurmountable obstacles and problems, and apply those concepts to any issue we take on, not just in this office, but in neighborhoods throughout the city. I want to share some stories with you today in light of not only my first year in office, but also in light of what's happened over the last week. And it's my hope that you'll walk out of this room with a renewed faith in our city's future and with a commitment to making a difference, a commitment to investing in our Chicago and helping people in small ways and large ways every single day. When I received the call a little over a year ago to consider this, I was a reluctant recipient of the call. I should say we were reluctant recipients of this call. I just left what I thought would be a sort of crowning achievement in public service and helping the county board president turn around a unit of government that had been wasteful and inefficient and corrupt for decades. And I thought, it can't get any better than that. I was in the middle of leading a $2 billion enterprise at Grosvenor that was focused on investing in minority and women-owned firms, launched the first ever hedge fund of funds focused on that effort. I should say, as a side note, in its first year of existence was Grosvenor's highest performing fund. So the thesis that when you, that talent is ubiquitous, and that when you seek to invest in talent, particularly where it's been underrepresented, you will outperform the market because you're bringing new talent, new ideas to bear. And you, if you believe that talent is everywhere and that we're all capable and it is indiscriminate, then finding that talent means that you have a bigger, better mousetrap for the market. So I was quite pleased with what I was doing personally. And when I received the call, especially to return to public service as an elected official or pursue elected office, it was something that I struggled with, honestly. And as I tend to do, I searched with family and with my faith as to what my calling was. And it was very clear to me that something touched deep inside of me, a passion to make a difference and a deep-seated belief in the duty of service. And as I considered this opportunity, I was led to believe that I was uniquely qualified for this job to make a difference in a time of pressing need. What I didn't know was just how pressing the need would become and how many experiences in my life that I'd have to draw on to help be the kind of leader that the city needs right now. Honestly, I'd been preparing for this my whole life. As a kid growing up on the south side of Chicago, a product of Chicago Public Schools, Beasley and Whitney Young. I don't know if there's like a Whitney Young graduate here. There's always typically one in the room. Shundron, there we go. I knew since the age of 16 that I wanted to learn about investments and finance. I wanted to figure out how to leverage that expertise to help my community, because I would go on field trips when I was a kid. And I'd go downtown and I'd go to Lincoln Park and go to the zoo. I'd come back home and I'd say, why does that neighborhood look like that and ours looks like this? Why are they worthy of investment and we aren't? So I was that kid that asked the why and decided that if investment was what was needed, then I would have to figure out that skill set and bring it back home. So in the search for this, despite my or our initial hesitation to accept the opportunity, I quickly realized that serving as city treasurer would lend to an even greater purpose for my passion. And I focused on that purpose and got to work, as my grandfather would say. And one of my first decisions after accepting the opportunity to become treasurer was to launch an effort to visit all of Chicago's neighborhoods. We called it 77 communities in 77 days. By the way, on day 78, we took a nap because that was a lot to get done. Thank you. I actually started it before I was even sworn into office. And the purpose of the effort was a simple one. It was a product of my preparation as an investor. Do my due diligence. I can't be a banker, investor, and advocate for the city of Chicago if I don't know its opportunities and its needs. I can't talk about great investment opportunities that we have here, advocate for them, provide capital to small businesses, if I don't know where they exist truly, and if I haven't done as an investor my due diligence. I couldn't in good faith hope to serve all the people of Chicago without understanding their communities and their needs every day. And I have to tell you that the impact of those conversations, of the relationships that they spawned, and the insights that they delivered continue to influence how my office operates every single day. People have a real seat at the table. They are shaping public policy for their neighborhoods and for this entire city. And that's the way that public service should work. That's the way that public servants should lead, by directly engaging with people and communities who know what's best and what their needs are. And it's been a wonderful thing to witness. One of the businesses that I visited was a restaurant in the Irving Park neighborhood called Bread and Wine. Raise your hand if you've ever been to Bread and Wine. Let's see. All right. That's good. Hopefully a lot more after today. I sat down with the owners, Jennifer and Lisa, who are here today in the middle. There, raise your hand, ladies. And they told me about their amazing customers, Senator Durbin, Mayor Emanuel. While I was there, Senate President John Cullerton came by, and Ann Williams, the state representative, was having dinner. You guys remember that? That was really interesting. I said, this is great. We get a lot of great publicity. We have some, you know, Chicago famous patrons, but we lack the financing we need to successfully operate and to expand our business. So we listened and we responded and we were able to connect Jennifer and Lisa with First Merit Bank, who's been working with them. And in fact, we just learned that they're expanding their business to include a retail line of locally made products to be sold in grocery stores. So I want to say congratulations to the entrepreneurs at Bread and Wine. And hopefully you'll get a few more patrons after today. But we didn't stop there. Part of the diligence was talking to other city treasurers, talking to other investors, public pension plan investors, talking to trustees, talking to members of the plans they represented, talking to firefighters, talking to police officers, talking to laborers, talking to operating engineers, like my stepfather is part of the Local 150. Talking to these folks who have built their lives and careers serving the public with promises for their future, and what our options were for helping resolve what is clearly the largest challenge that we have fiscally in our state. One thing was clear from those conversations, and in this most difficult time for the city that we love, we need leadership at every level of government to rise to the challenge and to go the extra mile. Now more than ever, we need leaders who will seek the role that they play as both getting to work while focusing on how that office works, the day-to-day job that impacts every one of the people in the 77 neighborhoods we visited. I'm a firm believer that we're in a fight for Chicago's future. And this fight for the future, for me, began in those first months. I knew the job ahead was going to be difficult, but we needed to rise to the challenge because there was a pressing need, and it still exists today. And in fact, I would argue it's been exacerbated in some ways. What was clear to me is that in this office that used to be a sleepy little office on the first floor of City Hall hadn't made the contributions that it needed to make to the public and to the people, and that no matter what the contribution was, we're all in this together, and there's no contribution too small and no effort too insignificant for any of us to lead forward. That goes for elected leaders, civic leaders, community leaders, union leaders. I see Jorge Ramirez here, other folks who are here and part of this community. We all play a role. And the way I see it is, if you're in a hole, you've got three choices. You can wait for someone to come along, you can dig deeper, or you can start building a ladder and climb out. And sometimes, in order to build the ladder, which clearly is the right option, you got to have the right tools and you got to have a plan. There's really only one choice there. So within 90 days of taking the office, I laid out a pretty aggressive plan, and it had three core principles: transparency, accountability, and a commitment to serve all of our Chicago, not just parts, not just some people, every resident in the city that we all love. Much of that plan was aspirational, what we could do to help communities, help foster small businesses, create universal financial education. But within all of it, we never lost sight of job number one, the foundation of excellence in the office that we needed to build in order to do these other things. We needed to focus on that expertise, that level of excellence in this office, our core skill set of being a fiduciary of the city's funds, getting the level best investment for the risks that we're allowed to take. We have to keep in mind that our job as elected leaders is to make things better than when we got there. So first and foremost, the question was, how can we make this run better? How can we be experts at the thing that the public has given us the responsibility and the awesome task and honor to do? So we had to get to work in transforming the treasurer's office. We initiated changes, things like minimum credit quality, where in the past, for a single individual type of investment, we could take a certain level of credit, but there wasn't a maximum level of risk that you could take in the total portfolio. There wasn't a minimum credit quality that you were required as a treasurer to have. So what happens when the city's bonds are downgraded to junk status? What happens when our cost of financing is 200 basis points more than what it used to be? Naturally, if you're a treasurer, your desire then is to get more yield because it costs us more to hold that money. We shouldn't be allowed to do that. No treasurer should be allowed to do that. Independent of where the city's finances are, independent of the city's credit rating, we have to be held accountable to the public. There has to be a standard that we have for being a fiduciary of that portfolio. It didn't exist before, and now it does. And it's a matter of law. It's an ordinance that was passed this summer with the help of, I see Alderman Sawyer, Alderman Dow here, the help of the city council. So now we can't take undue credit risk on behalf of taxpayers. This didn't exist before, now it does. It takes a situation like the one that we're in to even know that that could be a problem for generations to come. The reality is we have to be the very best at managing taxpayer funds. We have to be the best at showing those returns to investors. We have to be the most transparent type of investor there is for bondholders, for credit holders, for the general public. And as I said earlier, we're just now operating at the standards that should be there at the Treasurer's office. That's not to say that our first year's work hasn't had a great deal of impact. One real-time example that we just saw in this most recent budget, when I walked in the door, I've had an interesting career where I've had to deal with turnarounds even in our family business and throughout my career in the private sector. The first question that you ask if you're an investor in a challenged, in a troubled company or an institution is, where's the cash? Typically, when you have a challenge like this, there's cash that's tied up in assets, there's cash that's tied up in working capital, and that's exactly what we were facing as a city of Chicago. We looked at our investment portfolio. We had $3 billion that was invested in short-term assets. Effectively, that's like us putting our money in a checking account instead of earning some interest on it. When we figured this out and we said, well, what's the opportunity here? I'm thinking, hey, I'm a new guy coming from the private sector. Maybe this is the way things are just done in municipal government. So we asked around and said, well, what's New York do? They keep 10 days of cash on hand. What do D.C. and Philadelphia do? 20, 30 days. We called our friends at the GFOA and said, well, what's the national best practice standard? They said 45 days. You know what that $3 billion equates to that the city of Chicago is holding? 4.5 months. So 4.5 months versus 45 days, something's wrong with that picture. Where's the cash? Cash is tied up in investments that aren't matching when we're spending the money. Our finding that and the impact of that is an incremental $40 million a year of revenue for the city. So for the next decade, that's almost $500 million that we're going to have that we wouldn't have had if we had continued past practices as a city. These are the kinds of things that we had to do in order to just be excellent at doing our job, excellent at being stewards of your finances, excellent at being accountable to the public and restoring and rebuilding public trust. What it means is less tax dollars that are needed, more money to invest in communities, more money for services. We also eliminated hundreds of unnecessary accounts and started to put dormant funds trapped inside them to work. Literally, with one of our custodian accounts, we eliminated 55% of the 109 bank accounts that we had. These were accounts that had existed for decades, and there were millions of dollars in there. These are functions that I have to say we were able to do with the help of the controller who's here, Dan Wadowski, budget director Alex Holt, the entire finance team for the city of Chicago. But this is not something that we take pride in. This is us doing our job. This is what you should expect from an office like this. I'll give one other example, and then I want to get to some things that I'd like this group to focus on before you leave here. When I was here last, I talked about an idea. It was actually an idea from a treasurer that was elected the year I was born, 1979, Cecil Partee. And that treasurer said then that he thought all of the different local investment funds, the local pension funds, who are investing separately with different sets of standards, different prices, different consultants, should be considered one Chicago, should have the value and the benefit of their economies of scale to benefit our retirees and our taxpayers. He was told that idea would never see the light of day, and in his lifetime, it did not. But a year ago, you know, a young, ambitious, bold treasurer said, "Hey, I got an idea." The reality is, these are not new ideas. They are ideas whose time have come. And sometimes the messenger matters, sometimes the politics matter, sometimes the willingness to put everything on the line and expend every amount of political capital you have to make it work because you believe it's what's right matters. That's what leadership is. So we went off 12 months ago. We said, we actually started with labor. We went to the trustees roundtable and said, "Guys, we see an opportunity here. We spend $150 million a year in fees. 80% of the managers are the same. 50% of the time, you guys are being charged different prices. Something's wrong with that. 0% of the time are you getting the benefit of the economies of scale." So when I go out in the public and I talk and I give this example to people, I say, "Listen, this would be like my lovely wife and I going to the grocery store. I go and try to buy a gallon of milk. They charge me $2.49. She goes, and because she's prettier, nicer, smarter, it's not even my anniversary, this is, you know, and just an overall better person, they charge her $2.29. Well, it's the same household buying the milk, same checking account buying the milk. We shouldn't be charged two different prices. And by the way, that same store has a $2 for $4 special. Well, neither one of us got the special, right? That's what's happening with every single pension plan in the city of Chicago, and arguably the state of Illinois. And it's not the thing that's going to solve what is a real crisis, but sure as hell is worth pursuing. And so I'm happy to report a year later, we've got 8 of the 11 local plans signed on to this clearinghouse. We've already started, we're launching the clearinghouse in the first part of next year. We've already started to see the benefit in the gain. From, I would say, forward-thinking investment managers like Northern Trust. They're nodding their heads there, who see the value and the benefit of strengthening their relationship with the city of Chicago, strengthening their relationship with these plans, doing their part to make an investment in the long term. And so we've seen it already lowering the fees of plans, investment by investment, manager by manager. This has the ability to impact our bottom line by $25 to $50 million a year, or $1 to $2 billion over the life of these plans. I want to give one other, in the interest of time here, there's another thing we did. I know you guys all participate in it, which is a quarterly earnings call. First in its nation, first of its kind in the nation. I just, honestly, I looked at this and I said, we have 2.7 million shareholders. We have $7 billion of revenue a year. We have $7 billion of investments. Any institution of that size, anywhere in any other context, would be accountable to its shareholders on a quarterly basis and would have to tell you what it's doing with the money and what it plans to do. Then we found out no other city in the country does this. So we said, let's start a trend. And hundreds of people join. Investors, bondholders, you know, John Doe off the street, they all join and they support this. And it's been, you know, by their accounts, a breath of fresh air and accountability and a level of transparency in the city of Chicago, which we don't have the best reputation for, right? So it's something I've been very proud for us to accomplish, in part because I made this point earlier. In Chicago, there is a need to rebuild public trust, not just with our investors and bondholders and creditors, but with everyday citizens and voters. Without it, we can't have the credibility to make the fiscal reforms that we need to make. We can't have the credibility to make the investments in people and in communities. We can't even have the credibility to make the reforms that we need to make in our criminal justice system without public trust. Finally, when measuring the impact that we've had in our first year, it's important that you know that we measure the impact not just in dollars, but in the people that we touch and in the lives that we touch. A few few weeks ago, I spent a night, this says on the street, but really in a park. I spent a night sleeping outside to support awareness for homelessness. And I saw Kim Fox there. She was supporting this as well, and a host of others, Alderman Kappelman. And we were there because it's so often the case that it's a group of our population that is voiceless and in many respects invisible. And we were there to give them a voice and to put a face on it. It reminded me of the difficulty people are having facing every day in our city, and people that are trying to make a difference. People like Corinne Fredericks, who's here. Corinne's a very special person who I met during my 77 in 77 effort. She attended a roundtable event that I hosted this summer with the Windy City Times to discuss youth homelessness. That conversation and sharing of ideas led to Corinne adopting a young man who had been in and out of her house, a friend of her son's, had been in and out of her house for months, and she didn't realize that this is a person without permanent housing. This is one of the 20,000 young people in this city that don't have permanent housing, that live friend to friend, home to home, family member to family member. And because of that discussion, she learned about the real epidemic that we have in the city, and she had it within her and in her heart to adopt this young man. And it's such a blessing to us to see that kind of impact. Corinne's spirit for the city and for helping people is contagious. She's one of those people that carries the weight of her community on her shoulders. And in my office, we've been connecting her with community organizations to share the work she's been doing for youth in her neighborhood. And we've equipped her with more tools to understand the ins and outs of city government. She wants to learn and she wants to empower others, and she's not shy about it. She'll email, text me, the mayor, Tony, if she gets your email, she's going to start with you as well. And I love it because she just wants to learn and she wants to empower her community. And that's the kind of spirit that we need to make this entire city better. You know, we have a saying in our office that's been our culture, and it's an acronym, and I'm going to draw it here so you can see how it's described on our boards. But it's spelled HDYHPT, and it stands for How Did You Help People Today? This is on every board in our office, at the top of every agenda. It's the first thing I see when I walk in. It's the last thing I see when I go home. It's the only thing that matters with what we do. And it is our underlying mission. It's what builds our culture. It's a reminder that we're here to serve the people of this great city, to make their lives better through our choices and our actions. And now more than ever, I want my staff and really everyone in this room focus on that mission and that question. How did you help people today? How did you help the people of Chicago today? Not just for yourselves, but ask the question of your teammates and of your family members and the people that you care about, because there's so much work to do. And it can't just be done by the elected leaders, and it can't just be done by the CEOs and entrepreneurs. It has to be done by everybody. It's time now to double down on the relationships with our communities and provide comprehensive help to people who put us here. One of the ways that we're doing this, I'm glad Terry Mazzani's here, is we've announced a new partnership with the Chicago Community Trust, where we're working to identify worthy recipients for catalytic community grants, investments for use in planning for these neighborhood futures, investments that can be used to attract additional investment from the private sector, federal grants, and more. I'm glad to see David Reifman here. He's going to be an important partner in this. The reality is, for too long, too much of this city and what it has to offer has been closed off to too many. And our job is to open the doors. Our job is to provide a seat at the table. Our job is to create that connection where people haven't historically had the access. And notice I keep using the word investment. It's critical. We need local investment in new ways. Earlier this year, the mayor announced that he would pursue local investment through Thrive Zones, through a local investment fund, through a local initiative. I'm here to remind everybody of that commitment and to tell you all that I support it 100%. And I hope with the support of the mayor, with David, with Terry and others, that we'll make that a reality. We manage over $50 billion of local funds. And we have, I said this here, I think last year, we have a strategy to invest in East Asia, South America, Western Europe, every other geography, every other market in the world, but the third largest market and the largest economy in the world. We have a mandate to invest everywhere but here. And what it means is that we're missing out. We're missing out as investors, and we're missing out in terms of our paradigm for the community. It's one of the things we hope to change through our investment with the Chicago Infrastructure Trust. I see Leslie Darling, the executive director here. Leslie is going to be, has been and will be a great leader of that institution, which I'm fortunate enough to chair. What you will see there is a commitment, neighborhood by neighborhood, for the greatest good, for the greatest number of people, for generations to come. Long-term investments that are good financial alternatives for our city. It's the only way this can work. And it will happen not only because we put our capital there, but because we're able to attract capital from others. We're not going to be able to do that if, as one of the largest investors in the country, we don't have a mandate or an opportunity to see value of local investments. What's it say to the rest of the world if we don't see value here as one of the largest investors in our own backyard? I don't think it's a message that we want to send. In closing, I want to leave you with a thought. Just 1 week ago, we were reminded that for all our progress, I should note, by the way, this is the 60th anniversary of the Rosa Parks refusing to leave her seat on the bus and the beginning of the Montgomery bus boycott. I think it's very telling that 60 years later, we are faced with inequalities that exist in our society. And this isn't the Jim Crow South. We are faced as a room full of diverse, very smart, highly educated, intellectual, well-accomplished people with inequality and disinvestment that literally, in many ways, has torn the fabric of the city that we love. We were reminded of this a week ago, that for all our progress, there's still a long way to go before every resident of the city feels like the playing field is safe and level. And this is not just a police issue. This is an economic issue. It's an investment issue. I must say this is also a leadership issue. The people of Chicago deserve and should demand more from their leadership at every level. Higher expectations of leaders, and even a change in leadership, as we saw this morning, alone are not sufficient. While I applaud the mayor for his actions, we still have so far to go. We have a titular head on top of a broken system that has to be fixed. And every actor along the way in that system has to be called to question, how are they helping people each day? Are they being fair and honest? Are they being equitable? Is the system just? And if the answer is no, then we need to fix it. And it's not just the leadership. Leadership matters. It's the entire system. And it's not just the police superintendent. It's not just the state's attorney, where there's a similar question. It's with the mayor and the county board president and the clerk and the treasurer. All of us have to look at ourselves and look in the mirror every day and say, are we doing our level best to help people? Are we investing in the right places? There is a very real sense of inequality in low-income, predominantly minority communities, where lack of investment and access to capital leads to distrust, to disenfranchisement, and eventually to despair. That despair leads to a lack of the value of life, both for an individual and for others that view that person. Someone close to me said, in the wake of the video release last week, people probably don't think of Laquan McDonald as having been or will ever be a productive member of society. My response, exactly. Exactly. Therein lies the problem. As a system, we failed a 17-year-old man who didn't get the support anywhere along his life. As a system, we failed in 400 days to seek justice. As a system, we failed in not thinking about the 10 people who were killed since then. As a system, we failed in the 528 deaths since his shooting last year. It's not a question of whether or not a person is or isn't a productive citizen. The question is, as early as age 17, have they been given the opportunity? Were they the kid that asked the question, why are we not worthy of investment? And until we make that connection, we still have work to do. As a result of this dynamic, where our belief is this may not be a person who's a contributing member of our society, the paradigm in which we invest is completely skewed and inappropriate to achieve the outcomes that we want to achieve as a growing, thriving, diverse global economy. We invest $500 million in a jail, $800 million in the court system, over $2 billion in policing and pensions, almost $100 million in a juvenile detention center, $500 million in court settlements in the last decade, over $300 million in criminal justice or related public assistance programs for those who have been affected. Meanwhile, unemployment rates in Black and Latino communities exceed 25%. We have 20,000 buildings in the Troubled Building Initiative. At our peak, we had nearly 40,000 homes in foreclosure. Now we have about half that, but so many of those home values have plummeted. And relative to the over $4 billion a year we spend on the criminal justice system and related activities, we spend a mere fraction of that on real community investment, on real opportunities in neighborhoods, investing in people and helping them thrive so that they can, in fact, be contributing members of our economy. So think about this as an equation. The use of resources that we provide today are inherently unequal. It doesn't invest in people, and ultimately it's costly. It's costly in lost wages. It's costly in lower property values. It's costly in lost taxes. It's a drain on resources. We want to fight our way out of a fiscal problem, and earlier I argued that the single largest challenge is our pensions, and I said I may have an argument to contradict that. Our single largest problem is where we invest our money, and our belief that those investments in the long run are leading to the outcomes that we want to have. We have an expectation for outcomes. We're not putting our money where our mouth is. We have a belief that it's someone else's problem when it's really all of our problem. If there's nothing else that I can leave you with here, is that we have an economic problem, and it's one for every taxpayer, every Chicagoan. And in the spirit of the bus boycott, you know, I'm inspired by the quote of Martin Luther King that said, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Our fates and our outcomes as a community are linked. We can no longer afford to ignore injustices, disinvestments, and inequalities with certain parts of our city, certain races of people, because it truly impacts us all. Each of our 77 neighborhoods has great potential, great entrepreneurs, great leaders, but they don't each have the same access to opportunity or to investment. If we truly want to be a global city, when I was here last, Marty Nesbitt talked about the Obama Library. And his message, in part, for those of you who are here, was we're about to invite the world to our living room. We got to clean up. You know, you invite company over, we got to clean up the house. That's what we have to do here. We can't ignore the dirty dishes over there or the dirty laundry over here. If we want to be a global city, we can't ignore it. It is part of what's in our household. So as I said earlier, when you invest in someone, as I was invested in it, it conveys some expectation that you expect a return on your investment. So what does decades of underinvestment say to those communities about our expectations of them? That's a rhetorical question. Hopefully we all get that it's time to invest in our Chicago. It's time for our banking partners to step up and talk about where they're investing their assets. It's time for our pension funds and others to invest in our city. It's time for more organizations to follow the lead of the Chicago Community Trust and invest in communities to help catalyze growth. And it's time for each and every one of us to ask ourselves, our teammates, our family members, our loved ones, how do we help people today? And then invest the time and energy it takes to make a difference, because it will be a long time coming. But I can tell you, this return will be worth the investment. Thank you.
Curtis left a little time for questions.
That was on purpose.
The oldest political trick in the book. Not a filibuster, he's just a... So, I don't know if we have any... Wow, little Amanda's quick as... Kurt, I don't know how to say this to you politely, so I won't. Short answers.
All right.
Dave Lundy, right off the bat. What do you view as your role in promoting the city's growing innovation community?
Yeah. I'm an investor and I'm an advocate. So when I see great investments, I want to support them and help them grow. I want to help attract capital to them. And I've been a part of, you know, everything from UI Labs to 1871 to the ISTC to ITA. You name the iteration of it that's part of our ecosystem here, which I think is growing and thriving. And, you know, for every one of those things that exist, I also meet an entrepreneur that talks to me about a lack of capital, a startup that says, I can only raise money on the coasts. So the role that I can play is I refuse to let lack of access to capital be the barrier for Chicago to be great in the new economy. And my role is to bridge the gap between capital and opportunity.
Ashvin Ladd, you're the barge guy, right? Yeah, all right, the barge guy, that's all I know. What is being done, or what can be done, to encourage more private investment dollars stay in Chicago to support local startups?
Yeah, I think, there are a couple of things. One, you know this, Ashvin, the state just re-upped its venture capital program here, another $200+ million to invest locally. I think this idea of a local investment fund, a local investment initiative, started back in April with the mayor's editorial. It needs to come to light. It needs to happen soon. And I think Howard Tallman at 1871's got some great ideas about how on the ground capital can be spent. But I think I think we have to put our money where our mouth is.
Two more quick questions. Jill Pollack, Story Studio Chicago. Where are you, Jill? That's okay. You have a chance to move up. Don't worry. I've been on my best behavior. Okay. How will you continue to build on what you heard from the communities during your 77-day tour, especially ideas from small businesses who practice a triple bottom line? I hope you know what that means.
Yeah.
Okay. Approach to using business as a force for good.
Yeah, I think there are a couple things. One, what we did in every community was we created thought leaders and think tanks for that neighborhood, for that community. And those thought leaders participate in a monthly phone call with me and a quarterly face-to-face meeting where they actually come down to the city council and sit in the seats of the aldermen and talk about their vision for the future of the city. That's the way that we've continued to engage with those communities, specifically as it relates to using business as a force for good. I'll tell you, this is an area when we were up in, I think it was Ravenswood. It was with you guys. All right. In Ravenswood, where we talked about B Corps, and we talked about the impact of B Corps on communities. That was fascinating. What was more fascinating was you had a group of people there who were willing to take their talents and say, look, I got an extra couple hours a week. If people need marketing help, if people need sales help, if people need this. What we haven't done yet that we have to do going forward is tap into the collective talent of this city, community by community, particularly when they're willing to leverage their time and talents, you know, beyond what's directly in front of their faces. And so I think it's a great opportunity for us going forward.
The final question, and obviously this is a city club, so there has to be some slight sandbag question, especially from Graham Grady. Where are you, Graham? A fellow von Steuben High School graduate. Let that be shown there. You ready for this one? You're really not ready for it, but right. Make off you are. Here we go. From Graham Grady, what is the one question you were hoping no one would ask?
Yeah. Well, okay. The one question I was expecting was about McCarthy, and thankfully the mayor took care of that earlier today. The question that I guess I was hoping no one would ask is, what comes up a lot in press and things like that about me, it's a double-edged sword that people kind of talk about. As politicians, folks always want to focus on your future aspirations. So it's a catch-22. I kind of want to be asked that. And my response to that is actually pretty straightforward. I just told you we are in the crisis of a century. Fiscally, socially, morally, economically, that's the job that we all have. All of us. Not to pontificate on years or decades from now. We have a job to help people today, tomorrow, and the next day, and get to work. So that's both the question I had hoped and not hoped to be asked. And I got to tell you one thing about Graham. I have to give you a shout out. I saw on social media your video and posting in peaceful protest last week, and I really appreciate your doing that as a person of stature in the community. It really means a lot, so thank you for doing that.
All right. That's the way I live. Really good. Nice finesse, wasn't it? That was really good, wasn't it?